right now, I just ask you to just breathe in the Holy Spirit. You were created to be able to sense His presence. Your heart, your mind, your hands, your body. He expresses Himself. He makes Himself known in many different ways. You just breathe it in for Him. And enjoy. It's a new one. Bring a rejoicing to your heart, a sharpness to your mind, praise to your lips, and a hunger in your heart.
Yes.
Come, Lord Jesus.
Yes. Yes.
Before I get started, I would be remiss if I didn't just quickly recognize and just let you know that there's so many people in this church body working behind the scenes for this weekend. And I realized earlier I sort of didn't mention that specifically, but so many people praying, interceding, preparing food, preparing the tables out in front for you, arranging housing, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I just want to say thank you. All of you, many who are not even here tonight, for all of your work in preparation for this weekend and support of the tables out front. You'll notice that our hospitality team decorated with gold and with silver. And I was just told coming in, they felt the Lord would move them in that direction because they wanted it to be a reflection of the fact that God is giving His best to you this weekend. So He lays out the gifts of gold and silver. And each of the little Bible verses that are on a little placeholder there are verses from some of the talks that you'll hear this weekend and some of the sharing. So as you're there enjoying food, take a moment to meditate upon those verses that take place in front of you. It's a fire school. What the heck is that? why do we talk about school of fire? Remember John the Baptist. I'm not the one, but I came to bear witness to the one. There's one, I baptize you with water, but there's one coming after me who's much greater than I am. His sandals I'm not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire.
Yes.
The Holy Spirit is the agent of God that works in our lives intimately and closely. You can't really separate God the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. They're one. Their purpose is one. Their nature is one. But yet, God has revealed Himself in this way very clearly in Scripture so we can relate to Him. God is so big, and there's so much more about God we do not yet know than what we do know. It doesn't mean what we know is wrong, but He is infinite. He is beyond our comprehension. And I think part of the joy of eternity is going to just be one revelation after another of the depths of God and the joy, the love of God, the plans of God. I don't know how much real estate is going to be in the new heavens and the new earth, you know, for you to sell, but I think there's going to be a lot. And the deals will be heavenly. So, you know, there's just so much about God we do not yet know. And it should be exciting. It should create a hunger in each of us for more of that. And, you know, so God the Father, He's a creator. He's the sovereign God of all the universe. His plans are secure. secure and sure. He knows the end from the beginning. He's laid it all out. As a plan for creation will not be done. Our plans, our rebelliousness are not going to stop God's plan for his creation. Sure. The decrees of nations, all of the however many accords we might enter in, our politicians and leaders might enter into, none of that's going to stop the plans of the Lord. Amen. And when it's time at the end of this age for the Lord to come back, he's going to come back. And there's going to be a day of judgment, and there's going to be a time when we usher in to a kingdom of righteousness and beauty. And that's his goal, is to prepare us to be able to live and serve well in what's coming. Yes. Amen. We're here for a short time. Yeah. But we're with him forever. Mm-hmm. And so we need the Holy Spirit. God the Son, the Savior, the one, the God with flesh and blood that we can relate to. The one we know as not only as King, but as friend. The one who we bow down before in awe and wonder, and we also sit next to as he leads and guides us as our closest friend. But also the Holy Spirit, God with us, the finger of God that touches us, that pushes us, that motivates us, and in our hearts that transforms us. And so we get baptized, we get soaked in, immersed in continually the presence of God through the indwelling Holy Spirit. And that Holy Spirit is a comfort, he's a joy, but he also is fire. We're baptized not just in the Holy Spirit, but with fire. And that fire is a fire of transformation. Nothing goes through the fire and remains unchanged. Everything that goes through the fire gets changed and transformed. And the only thing that's not transformed by the fire is something that has already been transformed by the fire. And when we talk about the fire that we are immersed in, what God is doing in our lives, it's a fire of self-sacrifice, the altar of sacrifice. There was burning continually. Where we offer up sacrifices of praise and worship and thanksgiving. But also we offer ourselves as a living sacrifice.
Yes.
In service to our King. It's a fire of full surrender. And I want to encourage you tonight, wherever you are, whatever your history has been, to just think again about surrendering yourself completely new and fresh to the fire of God and to his love. While we were worshiping, I felt urged to challenge you and myself with this. I want you to, if it fits with your conscience, okay? I'm never trying to push something on you. But if you can, with a clear conscience, I want you to set as a goal to leave this weekend more in love with Jesus than you were when you came. Okay? There's always room for more. And I remember a time we were in Africa, and it was both challenging and glorious. And I told the Lord one evening, I said, I need to love you more, but I don't know how. I feel like every part of me that I know how to feel with your love has been filled with your love, but I know that's not enough. I want to love you more. So by the Holy Spirit, I started praying, Lord, increase the capacity of my heart to hold more love. Increase the capacity of my heart and my mind to love you more. And that was a dangerous prayer. Mm-hmm. For about the next 2 hours, I laid on a concrete floor with fire ants crawling over me. That I became completely oblivious to. And I felt like electricity was just shooting into me in waves for 2 hours. And when I got up off that floor, God had answered that prayer. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I don't know how to describe it, but I was suddenly able to love him more than I had been when I laid down. So even if you feel like you love God with everything in you, I promise you there's more. He's infinite. Do not think you have reached the ultimate experience or encounter with God. I promise you you've not, and neither have I. And to me, that's exciting. There's always a new way to encounter our God.
Right. Come on.
And so I just want to throw that out to you. Leave this weekend more in love with him than you can. The fire of surrender, the fire of prayer, the incense of the tabernacle rising up before God. all the time. Intercessory prayer, embracing prayer, embracing a lifestyle of dialogue with God and interceding for His will to come and His will to be done in this earth as it is in heaven. And that prayer that Jesus taught us, it's a proclamation. It's not a begging God. It is a proclamation. Yes, God, Your will be done in this earth as it is in heaven.
Amen.
Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. We don't understand all of the mysteries of that and all the ways it plays out. And sometimes it doesn't work out like we think it should. Sometimes we get angry with God. Sometimes lots of things happen in the process of His kingdom coming. But that's what He calls us to as His people. Our kingdom come, our will be done. And then finally, in the holiest place, the place of greatest intimacy with Him, we have the fire of His presence, His consuming fire. Fire of full consecration, full dedication, nothing in reserve, nothing held back, refined by the fire. Refined and purified by the fire. And it's in that place that we experience what I want to really focus on tonight. It's in that place of deepest intimacy with God when we look at Him and the beauty of His glory, we recognize Him for who He is and what He has done for us. The consuming fire of God. That we begin to really appreciate what the cross has brought to us. What the cross has made available to us. Why Jesus came. Why He had to die. And it's in that great place that this exchange takes place between our heart and His. And you know everything probably I'm going to talk about tonight. But I want us to just put it together in a way that focuses totally, completely upon our Lord Jesus Christ and the cross. That is the center of our faith. The cross is not so popular today to talk about, even in many churches and many Christian movements. Okay? Maybe a little lip service, maybe one hanging on the wall. Because the cross speaks of a debt that had to be paid, that we could not pay. The cross speaks of a need for repentance. It means that I'm a sinner and I need a Savior, and so does everyone else. I don't just need to be polished up or made a little bit better. I don't just need to learn more. I need a total transformation in my life that only can come through the cross. And when we begin to live life in the intimacy of God, in His consuming fire, we start actually realizing what sometimes we only give words to, but it actually starts happening when we live life in His presence. And that is, we start realizing that, yeah, He took my sin and I get His righteousness. Not just in words, but in reality. I can give Him my sorrow, my questions, my doubts, my anger. I can give all of that to Him. And I get His joy and I get His comfort. I can give Him my shame and I get His acceptance. I start realizing I really do have a seat at His table. And it's got a name plaque there and it's got my name on it. It's not just nice words, but it's a reality. I don't just get to say I've got a good Father. I get to experience the good Father. And it's in that intimate place, that consuming fire of His presence, that we really start realizing beyond words and beyond the head knowledge what Jesus has done for us on the cross. I was raised in church, accepted Jesus when I was 9 years old. Listened to a sermon, felt the conviction of the Holy Spirit, went forward and received Jesus, and gave my life to Him. You know, I knew as much as a 9-year-old could know, okay, about what I was doing, which was very little. But I knew what I felt in my heart. And then I continued for weeks after that to go forward to the altar in our little church in Cookville. And there was something more I was hungering for. I knew it inside, but I was 9 years old. I didn't know how to express it. And our pastor was a great guy, but I don't think he knew what to do with this kind of weird 9-year-old kid either. And so after a few weeks of me going back up front every week, he pulled me aside and he said, "It's okay. You know, Jesus accepted you. You're saved. You don't have to keep coming up every week." I think he thought I was still worried about my salvation. I wasn't. But I didn't know how to express the need for something more. And it wasn't until many years later, through a lot of stuff that happened, that I was introduced to the Holy Spirit and the fire of God. And I'm still learning. And I'm still wanting more. I'm still wanting to grow closer. But I tell you, when you begin to live in that place of that exchange, okay, all of my junk for His glory, how crazy is that? What kind of God is that? There's nothing in us that has been broken by sin that the love of God cannot fix. Amen. Nothing. You know, I've heard people say sometimes, oh, I can't do that, or I can't forgive that person, or I can't get over this, or I can't break that addiction. And I'm like, you know, you just believe lies. Somehow you're trying to do it in your own strength. Because there is nothing that the love of God cannot fix. Believe that with all my heart. And I've seen the truth of it played out over and over and over again in my life, in our life together, in my family, in my church body, in many countries around the world where we get together and minister. But from the time I was 9, and certainly from the time 1983, but really from the time I was 9 years old, until just a few years ago, on Easter morning in 2017, I think, I kind of had this nagging question inside of me that I never felt completely at peace with. And that was the question, why did Jesus have to die? I'd been raised in church. I knew all the right answers. You know, I could go to the Bible verses. I could tell you, yes, Jesus had to die because the wages of sin is death. We all fell when Adam sinned. That we were born under the curse of original sin. And that had to be broken. That had to be paid for. And that Jesus was the only one who could do that. And on, I could give you those answers, as I'm sure you can. But God is so good. He knew that my heart, somehow deep in there, was not quite satisfied. From the age of 9 until almost 60, up in my upper 50s. And then Easter morning 2017, that's when it was, sitting at the dining room table. And I read a certain passage in Hebrews that we'll read in a minute. And all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit just started dropping in from me all of the scriptures and all of the instructions that I needed to have that question answered to the satisfaction of my heart. Okay? So I just want to share that with you for a bit tonight. I'm going to start sharing just some other things, you know, maybe you've heard and I've learned in the past, but it'll lead up to the event I was talking about in 2017. In Colossians chapter 1, let's just read it. Colossians chapter 1. Start reading in verse 15. Beautiful passage. Speaking of Jesus, it says, He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by Him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created through Him and for Him. And He is before all things, and in Him all things consist. And He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, and in all things, that in all things He may have the preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in Him all the fullness should dwell, and by Him to reconcile all things to Himself, by Him, by Jesus. Whether things on earth or things in heaven, having made peace through the blood of His cross. So the creation of which we're a part has the visible part that we see, that we live in, that we can touch and feel. But just as real is the invisible part that we can't, except through the eyes of faith and the revelation of the Holy Spirit. The invisible realm is just as real as the visible. And Paul says that the momentary afflictions of this life are beyond compare to what is coming. Because we as we focus on the things that are invisible, not the visible, as we focus on the things that are eternal, not the things that are temporary. And that passage in Colossians says that through the cross, through the blood of the cross, Jesus made peace with everything of creation. place of reconciliation through Jesus' sacrifice on the cross. So we begin to think about that, we begin to focus on it. And you know, the cross had its sort of background historically in the sacrificial system that God set up among the Hebrew people. Right? And you know, 1,500 years before with Moses and the institution of the tabernacle sacrifices, and even in culture, even prior to that, going actually all the way back to the Garden of Eden after the fall, when God made skins of animals to cover the effect of the sin of Adam and Eve. And God set forth a principle, it's in Leviticus 17, I think, where it says, the life of the flesh is in the blood, and that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. What does the blood represent? The blood represents your earthly, temporary life. The life of the flesh is in the blood. And it's true, there's no such thing as any kind of higher animal life that is known, that does not require blood flowing through its veins to sustain that life. And within their system, the value of the blood of the sacrifice was determined by the value of the life it supported. They had three tiers of sacrifices, if you will, determined by the value. There was the dove, the turtle dove. There was the sheep and the goat. And then there was the oxen. The value of an oxen was higher than the value of a sheep or a goat, which was higher than the value of a bird. That was sort of the tier. There's lots of details, but that was the breakdown, basically. And the value of the sacrifice, the value of the blood of the sacrifice, was determined by the value of the life it supported. Okay? So, what's the value of a bird, of a turtle? Now, all creatures are great, okay? Spent my life work as a veterinarian. I'm not talking about is an animal life valuable or not. We're talking about comparatively within the sacrificial system of the Levitical priesthood, okay? What's the value of the turtle dove as far as to support your life? Well, you could get meat for a meal for one person if you weren't too hungry. You can maybe get a few feathers to put in a mattress or a pillow. Okay. That's about it in terms of what could happen that support your life. That's why it was the lowest level. It was God still honored. And if someone could not afford a sheep or a goat, he made provision and he accepted the turtle dove. That's the grace of God. But what about the value of a sheep or a goat? You raise sheep, right? What all do sheep give us besides a hard time? And really stinky wool until you do something with it. Meat for a family, even more, right? What else? Wool for clothes. Yeah. Milk, goats, right? For cheese and milk. Skins for clothing. So a lot of things. There's a lot of value for a sheep or a goat, just in terms of to the family. What about an oxen? Okay, lots of meat. Big skins for tents and dwellings. Okay. Lots of milk. It's a milk. If it's work, they can pull carts, they can pull wagons, they can pull plows, you can plow new ground. So oxen are more valuable than to the goats, which were more valuable than goats. And if you look closely at their system, God only required an ox to be sacrificed when it had something to do with the community. Okay? Not for individuals, but it had to do with the community. That ox sacrifice. Okay. So, the value of the blood is greater than the value of the blood of a sheep, valuable, more valuable than the blood of a bird. What's the value of the blood of a man? Who is creating that? What did God require for restitution if someone willfully killed another human being? It was a life for life. If you killed your neighbor's ox, you had to make restitution. You kill neighbor, can't do that. Okay? One of the values that I believe in, with security, because their life and the decisions they're making affect so many other people. Now, intrinsically, their life is not valuable to any of us, human beings. But the way it affects community, it is. So we go into great trouble to safeguard those positions. What about the blood and value of blood of a perfect man? About a man who was God. This is touching on why it happened to Jesus that died for us. Yes, we all know that he was perfectly born since man ever said yes. But his life was the most valuable life that's ever been lived on this earth. Because of his ability, his power, his willingness to influence and affect every other human being that's ever lived or ever will live. And that's why that no blood less valuable than Jesus could ever atone for the sins of mankind. Because if it had been a lesser man, there would always be the chance that somebody better would show up. And then who could cover for them? And when the blood of Jesus Christ poured from the cross into the ground, it answered the cry of the blood of righteous Abel, the first victim of sin in the world. The first person killed because of sin in the world. And his blood had been crying out for justice all through the history of mankind. And when the blood of Christ flowed into the earth, it answered the cry of Abel. And it brought justice. And it established a righteousness and a justice that began then and will continue until its completion at the end of this age. Jesus did all of that out of love. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. It was love that brought Jesus here. It was love that took him to the cross. It was joy that sustained him through that trial of the cross. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, despising and shame. And when we spend time in that intimate place of his fire, we begin feeling and experiencing the power of that love, the same love that sent him here to the earth and to set his course to go to the cross. And we begin receiving some of that joy that sustained him so it can sustain us. But it requires being in that intimate presence of his consuming fire. He is a consuming fire. And he draws us into that for our purification, our refinement, our healing, our transformation. And it's a never-ending process. And it's all covered in love and presented to us through grace. You can't earn it, you know that. It's not about your ability to perform. Not us to perform perfectly, never have been able to will. God has called us to have a perfect heart, pure heart. And that means he begs us to him with things. That's all he says. So when you become aware, and it's through the revelation of his Holy Spirit working in you, he makes you aware of things in your life that are not in alignment with him, that are standing in your way of knowing him more, of being closer to him. And when you come to that awareness and that knowledge, you're just simply willing to do what John the Baptist preached and what Jesus preached. Kingdom of heaven is here. It's right here. You can reach out and grab it. And in this age, the violent have to take it by force. It just means don't be timid. Okay? Don't be timid about reaching out and grabbing, chasing after the things of God. We were not created to be passive, quiet Christians. We were created to be aggressive with love. Forceful with grace. We're not supposed to take the kingdoms of this world by force. That's a mistake some Christians make sometimes. They think that's telling us, we have to go out and take the kingdoms of this world by force. What it says is take the kingdoms. died by force.
That's right.
Everything in you, you're reaching out and you're grabbing hold of the things of God. What does it look like on a daily basis? It simply means you learn to want God more than anything else. And when you become aware of something getting in your way, you're willing to say, I turn from that and I turn to God. And if it, whatever, however stronghold it might be in your life, and we're going to talk about how to break strongholds and all through the weekend. Some things do have a hold on us. Okay? And they're harder to break. They're harder to get healed of. They're harder to get over. That's true. But do not fall for the lie that you can't get over it. That you can't be healed of it, and that addiction can't be broken, or the pattern in your life, the anger, the rage, whatever it is, can't be healed, because it can't. You just got to want God more than anything else.
That's right.
And there really is no shortcut to that. Okay? God says, when you search for me with all of your heart, then you will find me.
Yes.
He doesn't say, when you search for me with half of what you got. Now, God is gracious. He meets us wherever we are when we turn to Him.
Yes.
As long as we're turning in sincerity. Okay?
Yes.
So that's part of why Jesus had to die. There was this debt that had to be paid. None of us could pay it except the only perfect life that's ever been lived. The most valuable life that's ever been lived as a human being in this world. He had to be the one to willingly give His life for the rest of mankind. And in doing that, He broke the curse of sin, the power of sin over us. But there's more than that. Because all that's kind of in the visible realm. What about the invisible realm? Remember Colossians? He made peace through the blood of His cross, both the things that are visible and the things that are invisible. What's in the invisible realm? Heaven? Angels? Principalities? Rulers of darkness? Demons? Holy angels? Fallen angels? There's a lot in the invisible realm. How did Christ make peace with all of that through the cross? It's a good question. And I'm going to share with you what I received in that morning I spoke of earlier. Okay. Let's go to Hebrews. And it's in chapter 9. Let's just read it, verse 13, 14, 15 right there. For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifies for the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered Himself without spot to God, cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? And for this reason, He is the mediator of the new covenant by means of death for the redemption of the transgressions under the first covenant, that those who are called may receive the promise of the eternal inheritance. And then let's jump on down. This is what I was reading Easter morning 2017. Verse 22. And according to the law, almost all things are purified with blood. And without shedding of blood, there is no remission. Therefore, it was necessary that the copies of the things in heaven in the heavens should be purified with these. And that's talking about the tabernacle and the temple. The copies of the things in the heavens should be purified with the blood of sheep and goats. But the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. For Christ has not entered the holy places made with hands, which are copies of the truth, but into heaven itself now to appear in the presence of God for us. And that morning, this thought dropped into my head that in all of the, I don't know, hundreds of times I've read that passage, it never occurred to me before. Why did heaven have to be purified? That's what it says. that the blood of the earthly sacrifices was used to purify the elements of worship in the tabernacle. But in heaven itself had to be purified with something that could only be satisfied by the blood of Jesus. Why did heaven have to be purified? I never thought of that. I always thought of heaven as a pure place, you know, the dwelling place of God. I'm going to ask you a few questions that I know you know the answer to, okay? So, before Satan was Satan, who was he? Lucifer. Isaiah, Ezekiel, Jude indicate that Lucifer was a very powerful angel, like an archangel, probably even higher than Michael and Gabriel, because Jude tells us that Michael was very respectful when he was arguing with Lucifer, with Satan. Even in his fallen state, Michael recognized an authority. So Lucifer was a very, very powerful and important angel in the original creation. But you know what happened, right? He became prideful, he became arrogant. The five I wills of Isaiah, you know, I will ascend above God, I will be like God, and on and on. And he led a rebellion, right, of heaven. Maybe a third of the angels. Some scriptures indicate that. About a third of the angels rebelled with him against God, trying to overthrow God. But he didn't succeed. And he was cast out of heaven. He was cast out of his place of authority and cast to the earth. But here's the key that I've never seen. He did not lose access to heaven. Even though he had lost his place of authority in heaven, he did not lose access to heaven. He still had God's voice. He still had God's ear. Okay? How do we know that? The book of Job, right? The book of Zechariah, talking about Joshua the high priest, where you see Satan, the accuser of the brethren, coming before God. And what's he doing? Accusing the brethren. Yeah, look at him, God. He only loves you because you bless him so much. Yeah, you just, you know, turn off the blessing spout a little bit. You'll see the real him. And you'll see what happens. Just let me have my way with him a little bit, and you'll see who the real person is behind Job. That kind of accusation. And again, to Joshua, about Joshua the high priest, the accuser of the brethren before God. But something changed with the cross. And I want us to go to John chapter 20. It says, the day of the resurrection, again, you know this story. The women went to the tomb just before dawn. They found it empty. Apparently, most of them went back to talk to the disciples, tell them what they found. But Mary Magdalene stayed behind. She either stayed behind or she left and came back before the others. But she's in the garden alone at night. She doesn't have the body. You know, the story, verse 13 or 12. And she saw two angels in white, sitting one at the head and the other at the feet, where the body of Jesus had lain. Then they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Now when she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, and did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" She, supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him, "Rabboni," which is to say, "Teacher." Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father. But go to my brethren and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God." And Mary went and did that. Beautiful story. So much truth throughout chapter 20. Let's focus on said, "Do not cling to me." Some translations very incorrectly have said or left the impression it meant like, "Do not touch me." That's not what it says. If Jesus, okay, look at the scene. She sees Jesus, comes to recognize him for who he was. She loved him with all of her heart. What was she doing? What did she do? What would you have done? You know, hug the stuffings out of him. Okay? Right? You just hung on to me. And that's what he was saying to Mary. Do not cling to me. You can't hold me here. He wasn't saying don't touch me. Okay? Didn't have anything to do with Jesus having his name pure and undefiled. Okay? He was just being very, very practical. This is the only time in the Gospels you will see Jesus in a hurry. It is. He always had time. He could be in a crowd and somebody touch him and he would stop. Right? They could be arguing. And the disciples could be arguing and he'd make them stop. Sit down, bring the kids up here. Okay? He always had time. He would take all day ministering to people. Comforting people, teaching people, healing people, delivering people. He would pour out everything he had. But on this resurrection morning, he was in a hurry. "Mary, you can't hold me here. Don't cling to me." I'm adding some paraphrase here. So, you know, I think I'm being true to the scripture, but read it for yourselves inside. I think it was something like this. "Mary, don't hold me here. You can't keep me here. I've got something I've got to go do. I've not yet ascended to the Father. I want you to go tell my disciples, though, that I am ascending to the Father. My God and their God. My Father, their Father. I'm going to do that. So go talk. You can't keep me here. Right? That's something I'm going to do." And if you are here, throw to this. He's out of time. Right? He walks miles with these guys. And he starts Moses and the prophets. And as they walk along for miles, he teaches them all through the Old Testament. And then he goes in to have a meal with them. Until the breaking of the bread, they finally see who he is and he disappears. And then those disciples, Cleopas and the other one, they run the 7 miles back. They must have been in pretty good shape. They run the 7 miles back to Jerusalem. And they find the disciples in the upper room who are hiding behind closed doors because they're afraid that what they had witnessed happened to Jesus 3 days before was going to happen to them. Okay, who can blame them? Jesus was flogged like indescribable. Skin, muscles, everything stripped from him. He was mocked publicly. He was beaten beyond recognition. Before he ever went to the cross, he had already shed a lot of his blood, very weak in condition, physically. Went to the cross, did what he needed to do on the cross, which was accomplish the victory. Because you see, this battle that we're in, that we're part of, is a very real battle between kingdoms of light and kingdoms of darkness, between kingdoms righteousness and kingdoms of evil. It's been a real battle since the angelic rebellion in heaven started. We sort of pick up the story of that happening on earth in the Garden of Eden. But the angelic rebellion led by Satan happened before that. You see, the fall of creation did not begin in Eden. That was the fall of humanity. The fall of creation began in heaven, in the angelic rebellion, in the invisible realm. Does that make sense to you? We just sort of pick up the story of the fall of humanity when we read about the fall of the Garden of Eden. But Lucifer was already fallen and was the serpent when we first see him in Genesis. And so Jesus went to the cross. And as he hung there on the cross, all of the, in Isaiah 53, it says, the Father laid on him the And it talks about how he was bruised and broken. And not only his body was broken, his joints out of place, his heart melting like wax, his tongue cleaving to his mouth. He couldn't talk, he couldn't speak at times because of all that was going on. Not only was his body broken, but it says his soul was poured out as an offering for sin. His soul, not just his body. All of his heart. What is your soul? It's your mind, your will, your emotions. Everything about Jesus, not just his body, everything about Jesus was poured out as an offering for sin for us, for the remission of our sin. So what was happening in the cross, on the cross in those few hours? All of the weight of all of the sin of all of humanity for all of the ages came pouring into the wounds of Christ for a few hours. Have you ever felt the weight of your own sin? Have you ever been the victim of sin at the hands of someone else? And you felt the sting of betrayal or the trauma of abuse? But the hurt of the belly. You know it hurts. All have some form of injury effects. You know it hurts. Sometimes it feels like you just can't stand it. Anybody ever feel like you've been crushed by the weight of sin? Or by the weight of sin inflicted upon you? Now imagine that hurt magnified billions and billions. And in one body, for a few hours, all of that hurt poured into his body. It took a special man to be on the cross. It took not only a willing man, but the strongest human that's ever been. The strongest human in his soul. That's ever lived, totally surrendered to the will of the Father, to receive all of that weight and all of that evil and all of that hurt crashing in on him. But all of that darkness meant something in his heart it was not expecting to find. It meant love. And love won. Love won. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. This is the point where the battle between good and evil was won. This was the climactic battle of the ages. And it was settled once and for all as Jesus hung on the cross. And he willingly received all of that sin. He was made sin to be for us, that we might be made his righteousness. It's an amazing scripture. The perfect one, the one who knew no sin, was made sin. It doesn't mean he became a sinner. It means that sin just totally infiltrated him. And to those who were looking from the outside, standing there on Calvary that day, looking at the cross, it did not look like much of a victory. But with eyes of faith, with heavenly eyes, it was the most important victory ever. In which, with the power of love and a willingness to forgive, he defeated the powers of darkness forever. It was the decisive battle. And it will be fully realized at the end of this age when he returns. But the decision has already been made. The battle's already been won. Yeah. What we're doing now, and what God gives us an opportunity for, is to be part of the cleanup. You know, in every major war, there's a climactic battle where it's won for one side or the other. But then often, sometimes for years or after World War II, in certain places, even for decades, there were still enemy soldiers fighting the because they didn't know the war was over. Okay? That's what's happening with Satan right now. He kind of thinks he can still win because he's arrogant. Okay? But he's lost. And the way we win is to plug into the same power that took Jesus to the cross. And that is his love. Satan has no answer for grace and unconditional love. None. If you stand in grace and in unconditional love, if that's what you surrender your life to in Jesus, you will never lose. I don't care what happens to you in this world. I don't care what troubles, trials we go through. I don't care when death hits. We cannot be defeated. Even if and when we die. We will die unless we're alive until Jesus comes back. I don't want to say this like it sounds glibly, because we've all lost loved ones, closer than we're down through, and we're likely to die. But the truth is, death rate is just 100%. Nobody's out of this world unless we have the Jesus coming. But we cannot be defeated if we stand in love. That's the weapons of warfare. That's it. And that's what Jesus did from the cross. He died and yet we never have. So that we can have a life we never have. That's the character of every one of them. He's thank God that we can have a life we can never have. Okay. That's what he did for us on the cross. You know, this particular day, Mary came home me on something I'm going to do. So I'm back home. I'm in the fire. So what do you do? He is in the fire. For what purpose? What did that mean? Let's go to Revelation 12. I always hesitate to teach out of Revelation because it has got layer upon layer upon layer. So I'm not going to tell you that I understand everything that this passage might mean, but I will tell you I think I do understand this meaning of it. Okay? Revelation 12. Verse 1. And a great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on her head a garland of stars. Every star I've ever read recognizes the representation of the sun. Okay, go back to the day of heaven, it's imperfect. The nation of Israel, the sun. Does anybody know that? It represents the nation of Israel. Okay. Then, being with child, she cried out in labor and in pain to give birth. And another sign appeared in heaven, the whole great fire of the dragon, and sent it to the Lord and said, he's taken her thirst of heaven and given to the earth. The woman who had given birth devoured her child. This very became the capital to devour child. She had his born. She bore a child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. Okay, what's that talking about? It's a prophetic overview of the angelic rebellion led by Lucifer, where the angels revolted and rebelled God with him. Okay. Stood against the nation of Israel, the nation of God chose Israel for one reason, that there would be a people and a nation through which the Messiah could be born. He guided their whole history, pointing to that one climactic event. And he still has a plan for Israel yet to be fulfilled. But Israel brought his birth. Satan said, if anyone wants to devour the child as soon as he was born. Did Satan try to kill Jesus as soon as he was born? Yes. Through the trickery of Herod, at first with the wise men, and then later by having all the male babies killed 2 years and younger. Joseph was warned in the dream to take them to Egypt for safety, and was told he could come back here and die. Satan continued to try to destroy Jesus in various ways all through his ministry. He tried to have him thrown off a cliff very early in his ministry, and so on and so forth. He tried to destroy him through trickery, through deceit, through temptations, temptations in the wilderness, the temptation in the Garden of Gethsemane, and over and over. Satan tried to destroy Jesus anyway from the time he was born. Ever since he did. Okay. And then, let's pick up this verse. In verse 5, the last part of it, let's just read verse 5. She bore a child who drew all nations to rot around. That is clearly talking about Jesus. Go to Revelation 13, presents his back to the king, and seeks a relation to rot around. And her child, Jesus, was called up to God in his throne. When was Jesus called up to God in his throne? When did Jesus resurrection day. Jesus is on the throne now. Not waiting in the age. He is now in the Lord of Lords. The most exalted, the most authoritative name in all of creation. And it says, we're sitting there with him. How crazy is that? Jesus is with us. But the source is because it's a bit of a parenthetical that has a different prophetic, takes you in a different prophetic direction. But the narrative, the story picks up in verse 7. And war broke out in heaven. The New Living Translation says, then war broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought with the dragon and his angels fought. But they did not prevail, nor was there a place for them in heaven any longer. Okay. Satan and his angels had had access to heaven from the angelic rebellion that was before Adam and Eve, all the way up until the resurrection day. Everybody with me? But heaven, so heaven was defiled by their presence. And you think, well, why didn't God just get rid of it? Ask him someday, okay? No, in all seriousness, because this was a real battle that had to have a real victory. Okay? And there's only one redeemer in heaven and in earth. There's only one Savior for all of creation. And it is through that Savior, the one who became the mediator of a better covenant, that all of creation had to be purified and reconciled. That's why God waited. That's why God put up with the accusations of the devil all of those years against humanity until, in his wisdom, knowing it was the right time for Jesus to come and accomplish the victory. There's no other name by which man can be saved. And there is no other person through which heaven could be redeemed. Through which heaven could be purified. Okay? There's one redeemer, one Savior. His name is Jesus. So, verse 7, war broke out in heaven, Michael and his angels fought, the dragon, I don't know, if you like, if you're a person that likes, like, movies or sci-fi movies, see a picture of this in your head, okay? This was an epic battle taking place in the invisible realm between very real forces of good and darkness. Michael, the archangel of Israel, the warrior angel, Michael, leading an army of holy angels against an army of fallen angels. It was a real battle taking place in heaven. Talking about the dragon, they did not prevail. Nor was a place for them in heaven any longer. So the dragon cast out sort of old devil, saying to these more, he was here, and his angels were down. Now her love is in heaven. Now salvation in the kingdom of God. And the power of his Christ have come. For the accuser of our brethren, who accused him before our God day and night, has been cast down. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the blood of the testimony, and they did not love us. When? In salvation. And Jesus took the throne in heaven. On the resurrection day, Mary, you can't hold me here. I've got something I've got to do. I've got to stand before the Father. In his profession, with his first blood, he let me have an angel. Here's the good news. Have no accuser in heaven. You only have an intercessor. You only have a mediator. You only have one who gave his life for you, standing before the Father all the time, day and night, without ceasing, interceding for you, burning for you. Hebrews 7, verse 25, says that the power of man's life is given to the utmost those who come to God in him, because he lives forever to make sense. Every second of every day until he returns. You see, he's making intercession for the saints. And he invites us into the fire of his intercession. He invites us to take up the mantle of fire of intercession, of sacrifice, of total consecration. All we're doing is joining him in what he's already accomplished. He absolutely surrendered himself to the Father's will. He is living forever, making intercession praying for you, mediating for us all the time. He's burning. He's the burning bush that's not consumed by the burning. Okay? His intercession for you is a fire. Have no accuser anymore before God. So do not join, do not aid and abet Satan, who's confined to this world. He no longer has access to heaven. He can no longer go before God and say, oh, yeah, look at Eleanor. Okay? Yeah, she's not doing so good, God. She's not really doing so good. That doesn't happen. Okay? You have no accuser. I really want you to hear that. So do not aid and abet an enemy who's already defeated, whose total power lays in his lies and his accusations. So no word of accusation should come out of your mouth toward another human being. No word of accusation should target yourself. Do not accuse yourself. Accuse others. That enemy has been defeated. Let your speech be full of grace and of salt. Stand in love. Be immersed in the fire. Why did Jesus have to die? There was a world locked in the power of sin. And that power is real. We do not serve in a faith that it only exists in philosophy, words, and ideas. We serve a God who has won the battle and broken the power of sin. Okay? So I just want to invite you as we close in this time of ministry. If you feel like coming forward for prayer, you're free to do that. Pray for me, receive, you're free to do that. If you just want to worship, if you just want to thank God for what he's done, whatever you feel like you need to do. But I want to invite you tonight as we begin this conference, step into the fire. Step into the fire that Jesus is. And see what he does. Let him break you free from every remnant of the accusation. Break you free of every power of sin in your life. He has won the battle. So just join in prayer. Father, we just thank you so much. I thank you for the cross of Christ. As Paul said, if I'm going to boast in anything, let it be the cross of Christ, through which I have been crucified to the world and the world crucified to me. Thank you for the truth that we're no longer citizens of this world. And those aren't just words. We are free. We are free from the powers of this world. And we are fully submitted to your power, to your love. We accept the truth of that. Now, Lord, do within us, accomplish within us anything and everything you need to, that we may fully experience and live that kind of life. Free from the power of the sin of death, of the fear of death. Free from the power of accusations, not to the guests. Free from oppression. Free from condemnation. Free. When the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is life. Thank you, Jesus, for dying. courage and power to take one step deeper into your fire that we've gone before. To feel the fire of your life burning in us and through us and over us. Shake us, move us. Shake us, move us. Father, reveal yourself more to us. That we will never again want to hold on to something that is against you. Fill us with your love. Fill us with your love. Fill us with your love until nothing else matters. Fill us with your love. Till everything falls into place. Jesus, thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross. Forgive us if and when we've ever been ashamed to speak of the cross. Let us never be ashamed of the gospel. It is the power. It is your power for salvation. Give us the wisdom of how to speak to a world that doesn't want to hear of sin and the need for salvation, the need for repentance. Give us the love to be able to reach them.
So purify my heart, let me be as gold and precious silver. Purify my heart, let me be as gold and pure as fire.
Just a moment while you have your head bowed, eyes closed, please. Is anyone in here who's never said yes to Jesus, who never asked Jesus to forgive you of your sins and come into your heart? Just raise your hand if you're here. Don't miss the moment if you're here and never received Jesus. I don't want to make an assumption. Position yourself to go one step deeper into the fire than you've gone before. Whatever that looks like for you. If you would just acknowledge it with raising a hand or something. Thanks so not counting. I'm not going to. It's not that. I want you to just activate that faith some way, with a raised hand or a step forward or something. A voice of praise, whatever it feels like. Activate faith. Faith, activate, do it. Sometimes you have to go ahead and step one step to your body.
Ready to do your will. Ready to do your will. Ready to do your will.